for those that didn't read the write-up, what happened to me in my last attempt in a very short, plain and simple way was I got hit by an insane 70-knot storm out of nowhere. It was forecasted to drop down to 15, 10 knots, and instead I got 70 knots and 8, 9-meter seas, which lasted for about a day and only dropped down to 40s, 45s for the next 2-3 days following. And during that storm, my boat flooded and I lost my batteries. And essentially, I was unable to continue on for the rest of the journey. I made the call to hand steer the boat for 3 days back into Gladstone. I was battling hallucinations, sleep deprivation, lack of food because I was unable to leave the helm. It was pretty nuts. But I've jumped back in with the help of some locals from Gladstone, and I'm doing the project again. And I want to fill everyone in on what's actually happening with this refit. I've been training really hard and working really hard to build a crazy machine that's capable of doing it. Design brief from myself was I was trying to build a system with a full large spare battery bank. So in the case that I was hit by lightning or I somehow drowned my other batteries, some cells failed, that I would have a full spare 200 amp battery to rely on, which I could just switch out, or that I could run an entire system off and rewire it under anchor. I went through, and I also wanted to include the ability to have satellite internet communications, and within the last few months it's been Starlink has come in and become far more readily available. So I went to Kim Scott at Validate and we worked through designing a system that I could use to connect myself to the internet, high-speed internet, all the way around the country. And this was a bit difficult to do because the Starlink systems, they typically run off AC power. I moved to using a power over Ethernet converter to power my Starlink dishy. And at the moment, I'm looking at ways to make that dishy fully waterproofed. I'm using the RV version of the Starlink disc, which is typically designed for RVs and caravans or home internet, and I'm putting that on the back of the boat. The reason why I'm using the RV version is it consumes far less power. There's a maritime version out at the moment and a large flat disc, but these draw far more power, and the maritime version currently costs $5,000 a month to operate. Star mount systems, which makes a flat panel modification for Starlink dishes. I'm going to be trialing that to see if I can cut down my dish and essentially turn it into a flat panel, which will allow me to have it fully IP68 waterproofed. And that should allow me for, say, 3/4 of my journey by 2023 to be covered with satellite internet. And that's faster internet than you can get in your house. So that means there's a possibility that during some legs in the Southern Ocean, I can be doing live crosses to TV, doing interviews, live streams on my socials. It's gonna be something that we haven't really seen before in ocean racing. Typically you'd get a really fragmented interview or a file which you have to send off when you're close by cellular data, but this actually allows far greater communication, and I think we're gonna see some variant of this on every race yacht in the next 5 years as it becomes more readily available. At the moment, for me, this option is actually more attractive than using a second sat phone. So for the cost price of, say, $1,500 after I've done all my messing around, I'm gonna have full satellite internet capabilities for the majority of my journey. 300 megabits per second, it's gonna be phenomenal. And yeah, I'm with all my electronics parts, I've been out of Validate using their 3D printers to design and print parts. So as I was designing my switchboards and breakers, I had the full flexibility to go onto Fusion 360, design a part, print it, test it, remodel, print it, and have my switchboards, my mounts for my breakers, mounts for my 9-axis sensors in my BNG system, and a whole lot more just readily available. So instead of having to have these things fabricated for me, I had the ability to go and print them. And I bought myself a $200 3D printer off Facebook Marketplace, taught myself how to use Fusion 360 with the help of my friend Cameron, and within about a week I was firing off parts. And from Fusion 360 I've also been able to start to design a carbon fiber cabin top, which will give me a bit more coverage over my cabin, a bit of sun protection, and I'll be designing that and CNC routing some carbon fiber panels to essentially build myself a bit more of an enclosure. When it comes to my electronic systems, I had this vision that I wanted to build, and that vision included BNG electronics. At the moment, they're the best on the market by far. There's not really any competition. I was running older Raymarine gear, but I got in contact with BNG, and the guys at BNG have jumped on with wholehearted support. And what we're putting into this boat is essentially what you'd see in a TP52 with some slight alterations. In my system, I'll have a H5000 autopilot, top-of-the-line compasses, wind sensors. I will be running a Zeus 9 and a Zeus 12-inch screen, one for the interior and one for the exterior. And the way that I'm actually putting this in the boat is through Southern Seas Marine, who are commissioning everything for me. So in the early stages of this project, I would sit down and have meetings with BNG and Southern Seas in a combined meeting, and we would brainstorm over redundancy, over what I actually needed in my systems, how I was going to manage my systems with Master Vault. And we would sit and brainstorm these ideas on a whiteboard, and these guys, who are all extremely well versed in what they do and all engineers, in terms of onboard water supply, I also decided that I would like a electric water ballast system. And I sat down with my friend Theo from Stefan Racing, and we designed a electric water ballast system which uses gulper pumps to transfer my fresh water from side to side in the boat. So I'll have two tanks which and a switch which I can use to pump my water ballast from one side of the boat to the other, and using fresh water to conserve space. Ray from Southern Seas jumped onto this, and through Theo and my ideas, we went and developed a more refined version of this water ballast system. So Ray helped me nut out the few problems we had with this system, and as I progress on into the new year and I have the cash available, I'll be building tanks and using gulper pumps to transfer my water ballast from side to side. Southern Seas will also be installing speakers, sound systems. They'll be doing my management for my cabling between my batteries and my my DC outputs. Between Master Vault, BNG, Relyon, and Southern Seas Marine, essentially these companies all came together to help me design one of the most extensive electronic systems that's ever gone into a boat this small. Dare I say it, the most extensive. A mini Transat typically wouldn't be running anything near this, but it also wouldn't be taking on a journey of this length and this complexity. Using the BNG systems will help me navigate through very complex waterways, through I can't thank these companies enough for what they've done. Banjin, Southern Seas Marine have sat down and nutted out every problem that I could possibly have. We've designed this insane system, which I can show you part of it here. And yeah, essentially they've acted to really make this refit happen. Without them, I wouldn't be doing this. A lot of the finer details I spent months working through how I was going to actually implement this. I spent months planning how this was gonna happen. Spent time physically actually going through and wiring all of the systems, consulting engineers on how I should be doing what I'm doing, developing wiring diagrams, and yeah, pushing this little boat to its absolute limits for Australia's hardest yachting record and one of the most intense sailing records in the world. Also brought onto the team was RoadPod. RoadPod manufacture a very unique logistics solution, which I would urge you to check out. Got a bit of a video here. And RoadPod, with their manufacturing abilities, they've jumped on board and helped me as my main manufacturing partner as well. With a lot of prototyping with PVC, I've found a way to fit two large beds in, something again that Mini Transits just have never had. And the engineers at RoadPod helped me work through, design a system. We had to adjust a few things, but now I've got them fully assembled, ready to go in the boat. Again, another use of Fusion 360 and 3D design to help me build parts in my boat. The quality of these is fantastic and I can't wait to have an actual bed to sleep on. I've drawn a lot of inspiration in my project from one of my partners, Ocean Crusaders. They have been doing some amazing things with their yacht Jaybird, one of the first all-electric yachts doing the Sydney to Hobart race. And I've definitely pinched some ideas and collaborated with Ian on how to make my boat a little bit more like their boat. They're doing amazing things and I would urge you to follow them in the Hobart as well. Also jumping on board for the project is PredictWind, who will be providing a subscription to their premium service, which I'll be using in my lead up, in my training, which I've already been using while I'm out on the water. And they will be instrumental in providing data for my trip. I've also spent time over the past few weeks preparing my boat for the installation of a product called MacGlide. MacGlide is a replacement for traditional antifouling. MacGlide is a non-toxic alternative to antifouling. So instead of using harsh chemicals to repel fouling growth, they use a silicon base layer and a vinyl wrap. Expecting to see an increase in boat speed of over 4 to 5% based on lab tests that have been conducted in Europe. The wrap essentially uses the same technology as prop speed covering for propellers. So my boat is covered in silicon, which wrap is used to create an osmosis barrier and protect the boat from silicon. Typically with prop speed, you prime it and put a couple of layers down because silicon actually eats into metals. But with the wrap acting as a barrier layer, the MacGlide can be installed and function really well. The MacGlide has gone on and looks absolutely fantastic, and over the course of the trip it's expected to take 2 days off what I'm actually doing. So that's a fantastic contribution. It's slightly more self-cleaning than other ablated antifouls, and also filling my time and doing some racing with a slightly bigger pink boat, Stefan Racing. I've been really privileged to come on board with Grant Warrington and do a lot of lead-up races to the Rolex Sydney to Hobart for this year, and I'll be doing that on board Stefan. Really cool to get on board boat with such amazing systems, fantastic crew, and do some really cool racing on that. Really, since my last attempt, I've been out on the water training as much as possible. I've been training without electronics, so I've had to sail largely double-handed. I've sailed single-handed a few times, but it's far more difficult when you don't have an autopilot. I'm pushing it as hard as I can with what I've got. So I'm working through and trying to get these electronics back in my boat as soon as possible. And I'm planning to go sailing down the east and south coast before I go and do my next attempt. It's really surreal to be undertaking a project where a lot of people don't believe that it's even remotely possible. And when you fail initially, people lose more faith. But I think failure is the best building block for a bit of good old-fashioned motivation. So I'm going to send this little 21-footer around the country in record speed. I'm going to beat the record 50-footer and send it. And to be honest, I'm going to keep doing it until I got it. At the moment, pretty much daily, I've got people coming up to me on the docks in the shipyards and telling me what I'm doing is straight up impossible. And they use the fact that I failed in my last attempt to validate themselves that essentially it's not possible what I'm doing and that I should quit. It's actually really good fun building something this insane while people think that I can't. And really I stand on the shoulders of my amazing sponsors and the people that are supporting me to go and do this. People have got every reason to say that you can't do it in a 21-foot boat. It's not possible. Go get an S&S 34, go get a 40-footer and do something sensible. I'm having a lot of fun building this insane little machine, and I'm going to go and get this record. Anyway, that's my update with how the project's going so far. I've been a bit quiet. I've had a lot on my plate, and I'm just going to keep grinding, getting out there and sailing. Thanks, guys.